And now we're going to transition into a couple of specific surveying applications of GNSS. The first one we'll talk about is static GNSS. This is where we're getting high precision GNSS measurements. This is used in the development of global reference frames. It's used for tracking plate tectonic motions, studies of large earth movements caused by, like I said, earthquakes, volcanoes, groundwater subsidence. Actually, GPS velocities are used quite a lot in my own research to study things like faulting and crustal mechanics. And here's the anatomy of this system. We've got a monument, monumented into the ground, deeply rooted in bedrock, ideally. The receiver is inside of this dome, which protects it from multipath signals. And then it has, in this particular case out in the field, it's got a solar panel for power, and it's got some batteries and communication devices here in this box. So this would be a permanent, continuously operating GNSS station, something like a core station. Now, if you're going to really do this high-precision GNSS, you need to have really stable monuments. Ideally, you'll have multiple stations, because then you can sort of keep track of a large area and allow them to reference to each other. A lot of sophisticated processing goes into these, updated orbits, collecting lots of data. Using the carrier phase allows you to get even more precise measurements than your regular pseudocode is called, your CA code that we talked about. These are obviously dual frequency receivers to do those atmospheric corrections, and then using high precision data and with several years of data. So these stations are out there continuously making measurements all the time. And you can use these to track motions of tectonic plates to down to a millimeter or two per year, or even less. Projects that I've worked on involve this kind of data in New Zealand, in California, Hispaniola, Central America, lots of places where you've got tectonic deformation happening. We can track that motion down to this level of accuracy using this high precision GNSS. These are, as I said, usually oftentimes permanent stations, which are recording data continuously. But you can also do this with campaign stations. And this is done where you have benchmarks in the ground and you periodically go back out and resurvey those locations. And for example, in tectonically active areas, you might have a station move a couple of centimeters every year. And so by going out year after year and measuring that benchmark, you can precisely identify where it is, how fast it's moving. So what's possible? This is the stuff that's being used to track plate motions and earthquakes, as I mentioned. But also new kinds of things, new kinds of applications are coming out all the time. Soil moisture and snow depth is one. Water levels, sea level is another new application of GNSS. Volcanic activity, keeping track of how volcanoes are inflating and deflating, and trying to use that to predict when the next eruption might happen. All right, so we've talked about static GNSS. We've talked about how GNSS works. Let's talk about real-time kinematic GNSS. And it's used quite a bit for geophysical applications and geoscience applications. So let's jump in. And the question is that we want to address is we want to have precise locations with our GNSS. We'd like to have sub-centimeter locations, but at least a few centimeter accuracy without having to spend hours and hours surveying. So we can go out, we can set up our equipment, we can measure for 8 hours, and we can get, accuracy of a centimeter or so. But we'd like to have precise positions without having to do that. What could we do? Well, the way to answer this is to think about what are the error sources that are involved with a GNSS signal. These include satellite clock errors. It includes the ephemeris errors. This is the errors in the satellite's location. This includes the atmospheric errors, troposphere and ionosphere. It includes the effect of satellite geometry. So if your geometry, if all the satellites are in one particular part of the sky, that's not going to be as good of a constraint on your position as if you sort of have satellites distributed around the whole sky. So this dilution of precision. Multipath, so you can have signals that are bouncing off of other things, hitting the GNSS antenna. And then of course you can just have receiver quality being bad or human error, things like this. Now of these error sources, several are going to be very similar for nearby stations. So the satellite geometry, the ionosphere, the atmosphere, the satellite locations, these are all not going to really change too much if you're not too far away from, if you have two points that are not too far away from each other. In fact, they'll change very slowly or very little over distances of, let's say, less than a couple of miles. And you can use this information to sort of get the corrections that we would like to get. And this is how it works. We use two GNSS receivers, one of which has a known location, and we're going to transmit corrections from that GNSS receiver to another receiver, and then use that correction to update the position of the second receiver. How does that work? Well, we have our base station here on the left, and this station is going to be set up either over a known benchmark, or it's going to be set up to record data for several hours. So this could either be a static station that we're just collecting on the fly, or we could have done that before. We could have previously surveyed a benchmark, for example, and we'll go just set up our station over that location. And it's a known location in that one. And then we have our rover. And our rover is going to be going around. We'll use that to survey all of our points. But it's going to have an antenna on that that will allow it to receive corrections from the base station. And so what's going to happen is the following. Both of the GNSS receivers are going to be looking at the same set of satellites, but the base station is going to be sending a signal to the rover, which tells the rover what kind of offset the base station has. The base station measures its location at one particular point in time, and then it compares that to its known location, does the difference, sends that as a correction to the rover. And the assumption here is that whatever the difference is between the base's estimated location at one particular point in time and the known location, whatever that offset is, that's going to be the correction that needs to be applied to the rover. And it turns out that this works remarkably well. We can get down to accuracies of a couple of centimeters with RTK GNSS. So as long as you're not more than a couple of miles apart, normally your RTK accuracy is going to be a couple of centimeters. The base station needs to have some certain characteristics. It needs to be usually highly elevated compared to the rover locations. This says 10 kilometers. It kind of depends on your setup. Some radios will only go for a couple of miles. Some will go for farther than that. So as long as you have radio communication between your base and your rover, you'll be okay. And ideally, you'll be set up over a known monument with your base station so that you already know what that location is. You plug that into the GPS, and then it starts making measurements and does that comparison with the known location. The rover is typically going to be going around to different points and measuring them. And each point you only need to measure for 5 to 120 seconds is what this says. I typically will do 30 seconds. If you wanted to get a little bit more accurate, you might say a minute. And it's going to sort of average over that 30 seconds to a minute of time and get an average position for that location, which is going to be the location of that point, the RTK position of that point. And like I said, typically that accuracy is going to be around a couple of centimeters. All right, so if you don't happen to know your base station location, you can still do RTK GPS. In that case, it's called PPK GPS, post-process kinematic. And the way this works is that you collect your positions. You, after the fact, after your survey, you go back to the office. You upload your data to OPUS or to CSRS or to some other service, which does the post-processing of your base station. You get a position for your base station, and then you update your coordinates with that in your software. So here in the green dot is our initial base station location. And this is if you're doing PPK, for example. Here's our initial rover location. So at this particular time, there is T1. The measured location of the base station is over here. The whole idea here is that your GPS, your base station GNSS, is making measurements of its location. And that location is bouncing around because of all the errors and uncertainties. And so you need to take that. Here's your T1 measurement. Here's your T1 measurement. And you're going to add in the correction between your T1 location and your green dot. And that's going to give you your T1 corrected location at your rover. Stop measuring. You go to another location. You take another measurement with your rover. Its initial position is here. But at that particular time, T2, your base station is measuring a location over here. And it says, hey, I've got this offset. So it's going to send that offset over to the rover. And it will get it a corrected position, which is the correct position for that rover. And again, with post-processing, you'll end up at the square. Same thing at T3. At T3, maybe your dot is over here, your measured base station position. So it will take the difference again between that green dot and your T3 time, and it will add that to your rover position. And again, in post-processing, you'll end up in this final position where the square is. So this kind of two-step process here, where you're sending a correction from your base station to your rover, you update your position, and then if you're doing RTK, that's all there is to it. You have your final position. But if you don't already know what your base station position is, maybe you do your post-processing and that position updates, you just simply update all of your points in that same way. Post-processing is only necessary if the base was set up over an unknown point. So if you have a known benchmark, which you're going to set up your base station at, then you don't need to do the whole post-processing thing. You send the corrections to your RTK unit, and you immediately get a correction, and you get that updated position.